everyone. Today we're going to be going over proper squat form. So this is something that they don't really exactly teach you when you start working out unless you work with a really good trainer or you search out good online resources and learn for yourself. So today we're going to go over what not to do, what to do, and what muscles are important to activate. So first I want to go over a couple of the wrong movements that people do. You'll see this a lot of times in the gym, and in their defense, they probably didn't learn from someone who knew what they were doing, so it's not to say that, you know, they're an idiot, that they're wrong. They just don't know, because on this topic, it's kind of a, you don't know what you don't know. So, first I want to go over what not to do. A lot of people will roll their hips forward to cause an increased arch in their back, and if they're holding the weight, especially on their back, or if they're holding, for a front squat, if they're holding the bar in front of them, they're going to arch extremely as they go down. And if you try it, it's pretty uncomfortable. Some women have more of a natural, what I call, or what's called a lordotic curve, so that means a little bit more of an arch in your back. Naturally, we just have wider hips. Some people have carried their soft tissue a little bit more in their glutes, but that's a common mistake a lot of people make. Also, bringing your chest too far forward. So if I'm going down here, I'm completely bringing my chest toward the floor. Also wrong. Another thing you'll see is people who don't stick their hips out enough, and they kind of slide down as they go, so they're holding the bar here, they're kind of sitting like so. Those are all wrong because it's really easy and dangerous and can cause an injury if you're doing any of those movements. So I want to break those down to see what's wrong. The first one, the increased arch in the back here, can be from a number of things. Normally it is because of tight latissimus dorsi muscles. Those are the muscles right here and right here. Those are the back muscles that you see people doing lat pull downs when they're sitting in the chair, pulling the bar down. The lats are probably the biggest shoulder muscle that we have, so we want to use those to our advantage and train them before we put weight on a squat rack. It's as simple as correcting as training lats in general. Normally, it's easiest to use machines and cables at the gym. You could absolutely use a band, but you're gonna get the most benefit from using a weight at the gym. So weakness in the lat muscles, the two kind of flanky muscles that go from your shoulder blades all the way down to your hips. Weakness in them and tightness. A lot of people have really, really tight lats, which as they go down into a squat, the lats are gonna shorten even more, causing an arch. A way to stretch the lats is what we call child's pose. I'm sure you've seen it in yoga. You can sit on your knees, or if you have knee problems, you can just keep your knees out to the side like this. But you sit on your knees here and you walk your hands forward. For that one, you should feel a stretch coming from your shoulder, the bottom of your shoulder blade, all the way down to your hips. The second compensation, let's see, we did arch back here. Most likely a weakness or muscle imbalance, meaning one muscle is stronger than the other in the glutes and the quads. Quads are the front of your thighs. Glutes are the biggest of your butt muscles. There are three glutes total. For squats, you're using glute max, the biggest one, glute max, med and minimus, medius and minimus, named for their sizes. Glute max does what we call extension. So taking the leg from here, bringing it back. It also does what we call hip external rotation, which is turning the foot out to the side. So without going into too much detail with that, you want to train the glutes with things like, and those, these are all included in the workouts here too, things like glute kickbacks. And there's a few other specific things, fire hydrants, bird dogs, things like that that we are gonna go over that are in the workouts. You wanna train the glutes. Most people forget how to use their glutes or turn them off sometime in their lives. The glutes are the powerhouse muscle of the body. They are the strongest muscle and they should be definitely used to their advantage. Quads, most people are strong in their quads. Most people are quad dominant and weak in their hamstrings and glutes, so that will also cause a dysfunction with the squat from what we call a muscle imbalance. So that would cause an arch in the back. Other things that'll cause an arch in the back is weak glutes or weak core. So always core is a good idea, and core is not crunches. Core is stabilization while you're moving your arms and legs, either in a diagonal pattern, in a plank when you're lifting your legs, which is also in the workouts. I'll show you the core stuff. It's pretty much anything that crosses midline without directly contracting the core. The core is meant to stabilize, so when you take a deep breath out, you activate the diaphragm, which in turn helps you get ab muscles. That's a lot to digest, so feel free to watch this a few times just to kind of catch what you can, and the rest will fill itself in as we go. So another compensation people do is they bring their chest too far forward. That can simply be that can be fixed by looking straight ahead. So when you're doing a squat, you want to look exactly, find an object on the wall straight ahead of you, and look at that the entire time. Here, as I go down, my chest automatically follows where my eyes are, so my chest is going to stay forward. Another compensation people do is they don't stick their glutes back far enough. They kind of slide down. Now, when I first started squatting, I couldn't get that far without feeling like I was going to fall backwards because of a few reasons. So I would do the same thing. I would kind of slide down the wall here. Usually, it is caused by a tightness. Stay with me here. Tightness in what we call the dorsiflexor muscles. The dorsiflexor muscles. Okay, anyways. So, back to why people struggle doing a squat and sticking their glutes back and kind of look like they're sliding down the wall. It is usually caused by a tightness in the muscle group called your dorsiflexors. Dorsiflexors is not the name of a muscle, it's the name of the group. So we have your hip extensors, which include your hamstrings and your glutes. Glutes up here, hamstring on the back of your thigh, they do what we call hip extension. Dorsiflexors include muscles that bring the toe up toward the face. So when we walk, super important muscle as to clear the toe from the ground, if they weren't working, as we would take a step, we wouldn't be able to bring the toe up and we would fall forward. So again, dorsiflexors is the name of the muscle group that brings the toe up towards us. Now the name of the muscle that does this, and again, you don't have to remember this, this is just kind of food for thought. The name of the main muscle that brings the toe up towards us, you can actually put your finger right on top of where kind of like the lip of your shoe is. You can put your finger right there and touch it. As you bring your toe up, you'll be able to feel it. It's called your tibialis anterior. Tibia meaning the big muscle that supports the leg, the main one that's sticking out on the inner part of your leg. Anterior meaning forward. So the muscle is named for its action. It brings the leg forward, or it accelerates the leg when we go into a walking pattern. So the takeaway from that is that muscle is usually tight. There usually isn't enough stretching that we do for this muscle. So the best way to do this is while you stretch your quad here, grab right on top of your toes and kind of pull your toes toward your bottom. You're gonna feel a nice stretch in the front of your ankle. That's the tibialis anterior. When it's not stretched, it prevents you from bringing the tibia, the big leg muscle that supports right here underneath your knee. It prevents that muscle it prevents that part of your leg actually from bringing the knee forward. So if you can't bring your knee forward enough, guess what's gonna happen? You're gonna end up sliding like this. That explains why people kind of slide down the wall when they squat sometimes. Now, with that being said, there is a common misconception that you should not put your knee over your toe as you squat. People want you to squat in a perfect world like this. But I feel like I'm gonna fall backwards, and that's not how I squat even when I put weight on the bar. That's a complete and total lie. As you go down steps, if you were to watch someone from a side view, you'll see that their knee goes over their ankle enough where it's completely safe. Ways that it is not safe is A, if it hurts when you do that, and B, if you had a surgery or a condition where your doctor has specifically said not to bring the knee over the toe. As you do a squat, you want to keep that knee in line with your second and third toe. So as you squat down, your second and third toe disappear from your sight. Your knee is now in line with them and it's covering or blocking your view from them. So, if that makes even a little bit of sense, let's go over how to do a proper squat while I let my dog in real quick. Okay, so the way that you start squatting is by not using any weight, making sure you have no pain with this. Every facet of your form is totally perfect, and then you can add weight. Now, there is a difference putting the weight or holding the weight as dumbbells in your hand next to you or in the middle, putting weight on your back, and holding weight as a front squat. I would start with holding it at your side first, then progress up to your back, then progress forward. A front squat usually requires the most muscle strength in your quads, glutes, and back, so we're gonna wait until we kind of build up to there. A beginner squat, plain and simple. Feet are gonna go just a tad bit, I'll go this way. Feet are gonna go a tad bit wider than hip width, and feel free to follow along if you wanna do this in the mirror while I'm explaining, or if you wanna watch this, soak it in, go back and practice it. I totally suggest watching yourself in the mirror to make sure you're doing everything perfect, or having somebody else kind of assess you. I will be happy to assess you if you wanna hop on FaceTime. I have no problem with that. I don't want you to get injured. This is something you can carry with you, and you will watch at the gym. Other people will be doing this completely wrong. So, feet a little bit wider than hip width apart. Keep those knees in line with the second and third toe. Do not let them sink in under any circumstances. You have the option to keep your toes forward or point them slightly out. I have sciatic nerve pain, and without going too in depth with that, because that's a whole nother topic, for me, it bothers me to do exercises with external rotation, just like I just told you, which is feet pointing out. So I'm gonna keep my feet forward, but that's up to you, whatever's more comfortable. Just a little bit pointed out is perfectly safe. I want my back to be straight up, and I also, again, not gonna go too in depth because this can be a long topic, but I'm also gonna put my hands on top of my hips. You can see, hands on top of hips. I have a little bit more of that lordotic curve I was telling you about, so it's easy for me to kind of lean in an excessive curve. So what I'm gonna do is take my hips and bring my belly button to my spine, almost tucking my hips underneath my pelvis a little bit here. So I'm doing the opposite of what most girls do in pictures. As they're posing like this, I'm doing the opposite, where I'm not hunching my back, but I'm tucking my hips in just so that I keep what we call neutral spine. So that is a neutral spine, is keeping your spine in a perfect position. Yes, there are normal curves, but we don't want to put pressure on the actual structure, the joint. We're using the muscles for this. So I'm doing a pelvic tilt, taking my pelvis, tilting it just a little bit forward. Tilted my pelvis here. As you do that, I don't know if you can see very well, but as I do this here, automatically my muscles in my core and my glutes want to tighten. That's totally normal. That's what's supposed to happen. So those two muscles should be activated before you even begin. So again, recapping, feet hip width apart, a little bit wider, feet either pointing forward or pointing slightly out. Taking my hips, I'm gonna curl them underneath a little bit. And again, most women usually have this, so I would always recommend tucking your hips. And I'm gonna look directly straight ahead and find an object I can focus my eyes on. I'm also going to perform what we call a chin tuck, and I'm gonna take my chin and make it a double chin, pull it back. That keeps your neck spine and your low back spine in perfect posture. So, we're here, we're ready to squat. As we squat down, I'm gonna stick my butt back like I'm sitting on a chair. So as a good tactile or hands-on cue, you can put a chair slightly behind you, farther than you think you'll need, and that way you can aim your glutes or your butt towards that chair. So, for example, I'll put this chair here. I'm gonna be squatting up here, so that's farther back than I'm gonna, if I tried to sit on that realistically, I would slide right off, because that's too far back. So feet out, pointing forward, hips tucked, I'm looking straight ahead, and I'm pulling my chin back, and I'm gonna sit down now, sticking my butt towards that chair. Now that I'm here, you can see the curve of my back. I could put a flat plank of wood right here, and my back would be pressed exactly up against it. You can see my knees are directly over the second and third toe, and I'm looking straight ahead with a double chin, keeping my chest facing forward. I'm feeling a burn in my quads and my glutes, but I actively have to squeeze my glutes to feel that. As I come up, I'm almost thrusting my hips forward. So down, as I come up again slowly, I'm squeezing my glutes really, really tightly in order to kind of get that glute activation from them. So believe it or not, your glutes are actually not a main or a prime mover, a main muscle that's contracting in a squat. Your quads are more so directly involved. A glute is a stabilizer, so it's just there to assist. So before you go down, you turn those hips, core, glutes activated. They are what we call, another big term, isometrically contracting. Isometric contraction means you're tightening the muscle, but you're not using it. So if I'm holding a dumbbell in my hand right here to do a bicep curl, and I shorten that muscle, this is not an isometric contraction because I'm using it, I'm moving. An isometric contraction of the bicep would be if I held a dumbbell right here and didn't move. It's a stabilization muscle contraction. So isometric, non-moving contraction. You're keeping the muscle stable while another muscle is activating to help that muscle out. So glutes right now are isometrically contracting. Core, isometrically contracting. They are stabilizing the quads, which are the prime mover. So again, feet out. I'm not gonna point mine out, but you totally can. Knees in line with the ankles and the feet. I'm gonna tuck my hips here. Core, glutes are squeezed. I'm gonna look straight ahead, double chin. I'm gonna stick my glutes back. As I come back up, I'm gonna squeeze the glutes. As I go down, the quads are working. As I come back up and thrust forward, glutes are all moving. If you have any questions, please let me know. There's gonna be a paper that goes with this. Also, feel free, if you have questions about terminology that I used, please let me know. I want you to be clear on everything, and I don't want you to be confused because you don't remember a word. Thank you. Thank you for watching.